welcome to the scriptorium. This lesson is number 16, and we'll be working with the Roman capitals. Now, these are based on the Imperial Roman Majuscule of the second century, the most beautiful form probably that our alphabet ever achieved in Western culture. It has its limited uses. But even during the Middle Ages, it was recognized that the Trajan inscription, which was put up in about 112 in the Christian era, is probably the finest example of Roman majuscules in existence. And it's been studied and been honored ever since. And this is an extremely difficult program for me because there's much more that I want to say that I can squeeze into the short time we have. In fact, I'd like to have a series of 20 lessons just on the Roman caps. They're that important in Western culture and that significant. Gianfrancesco Cresci, who's, I think, the greatest of the Renaissance masters, who wrote a writing manual on the Roman caps, believed that they should be written. Now, the Romans undoubtedly wrote all of their caps or cut them directly with the chisel. They did not use mechanical drawing instruments. In the Renaissance, the use of mechanical drawing instruments by those who were designing large letters is one of the examples of too much emphasis on rationalism. It was a heresy of the Renaissance designers to attempt to make these things mechanically. They have to be written. And as Cresci said, write them the way the old man does, and they'll be all right. They'll look Roman. He called the Roman majuscules the queen of all the alphabets. He said if you can write Roman caps, you can write anything. And what a thing to work on for you, to master the Roman caps, knowing that if you can write them, you can undoubtedly write any alphabet that comes along. It will take you a while, but don't be discouraged. Study the letters very carefully. And I'd advise you to get a hold of reproductions, if you can, of the Trajan inscription in Rome. If you can't get that immediately, you can at least probably get a reproduction of the photograph of the cast in the Victoria and Albert Museum. And you can get the proportions and much of the vitality and liveliness and great power and beauty of the Roman caps from studying that reproduction. I remember many years ago, I was doing a sign in Roman caps for the registrar at Reed College, and the freshman stopped in my office. It was very late in the day, after the regular hours, and he said, "Gosh, Mr. Reynolds, do you do those signs?" I was an English teacher, and I said, "Yes." And he said, "But they look so official." And I said, "They certainly should. They have the whole Roman Empire behind them." And the Roman love of order, the Roman love of dignity, the Roman authority comes through in the construction of the letters. Much of the Roman art was done by imported Greek artists, and the finest art that the Romans produced was their alphabet of majuscules, their 22 letters. You see, we've revived Y, which the Romans tossed out quite early, and we added J, U, and W to give us the 26. But already I'm talking far too long about this, and we should get to work with them. They're in this book on italic because they're the perfect alphabet to contrast sharply with the Italic letters. And during the High Renaissance, there were no Italic caps as such. The sloping majuscules were developed later, and in France, not in Italy. The Roman caps are architectural in form. They need to be carefully built, and they resemble the details of the main elements of Roman architecture, the Pantheon in Rome and so on, but then I mustn't get into that. Maybe in some other program we can talk about the relationship between the majuscules and the architecture and the wonderful harmony between the two. Edward Johnson said, "If in doubt, use Roman caps, that they're always going to be legible and they're always going to be right, although there may be better alphabets for some particular job. But if in doubt, he said, use Roman caps. So they're a good thing to have in your hand. And Arrighi, who wrote the first writing manual in Italic, had the vertical caps. He added some flourishes to them, but they are essentially a Roman capital. Let's look at the cover of our textbook. The Italic at the top is done with the serifs and with the techniques that you'll find in the lesson on the Roman majuscules. I sloped them slightly, but down here in exercises and text, these are Roman caps. And in the example at the back of the book of two layouts, two designs, you'll find again the sort of letter which we're demonstrating today, although here it is sloped. But in the little example of book design, this from the preface to Milton is done in the alphabet which we'll be working on today. A combination of capitals that are full height and then caps that are called small caps. The F is full height, R-O-M is a small cap, the T-H-E small caps, the P full size, then small caps, but Milton is in the full size. The rest of it in small caps, and we'll talk about small caps later. In the Renaissance, the majuscules in manuscript work were often quite short. Today I'll be using a bamboo pen. This is a pen which I made myself. I teach my students to make them. We use just ordinary garden stakes, which you can get at any florist supply or a hardware store. And a bundle of them will provide you with hundreds of pens. And I like to work very much with quills, with reeds. I have some Italian and Persian reeds, but these bamboo pens are marvelous things, and they're readily available. And you can cut them to any size that you want. So if you look in Edward Johnson's Writing and Illuminating and Lettering, you can find excellent instructions on how to cut these. Maybe someday we can have a program on cutting quills, bamboos, and grinding fountain pens, which are pointed or ball-pointed, and making regular pens out of them. Well, let's begin in large size so that you can see the details of the serifs, because the serif detail is rough. The proportions are practically those that we had in the lesson on Italic capitals, the plain Italic caps. But with the Roman, the outside edge of the O should be a full circle. Now, you have to show your hand what a full circle is, and you can do that by running around the edge of a tumbler, around the edge of a cup, and train your hand to feel what a full circle looks like. You don't have to be as clever as Giotto in drawing a perfect circle, but with practice, you'll be amazed at how much skill you can get. I'll go through these according to their classic, to the width groups which we studied when we were working with the plain Italic caps. Never depart from these width groups. The O, C, D, G, Q are the ones that are almost square. They come closer to it in the Roman caps than they did in these plain Italic caps, as these should line up vertically, you see. Now, the fundamental stroke, which is in this particular pen-written alphabet. Remember, the pen angle is quite flat, and train your hand to feel the flatness of that edge at about a 15-degree angle to the horizontal. You knife to the right at the top and knife to the right at the bottom. And in doing the D, we turn to the right and then go into the wedding, go over to the left, and then back and down a little bit. That's why in the traditional book types, you will see a curve in here, but at the top of this stem will be an angle, and that comes from the use of the edged pen. see, this is an angle, not a curve, but the curve is in here because of the nature of that curved first stroke. The G, the one letter the Romans invented, is one of the most beautiful letters in the alphabet, I think. It is the old G, which we call the C now, with that upright, serifed upright added. Now here is our first example of this cusp-like serif, which is much simpler than many students imagine it to be. Just put the pen down and make this curve. Just this is all. You don't twist your hand, you don't twist the pen for a head serif. It's just a flat pen and that slight curve. Then you add a fillet on the left, a fillet on the right, come down a little below the point and then over, and with large sizes I like to round that just a tiny bit with the corner of the pen, getting an angle here. Whatever you do, don't get a curve down in here, and don't let this be up high. The upper arm should be raised, the lower arm lowered, and this angle should be down close to the writing line. We have Q now. We'll try a circle again, and it's hard to get a decent circle while I'm talking. It's hard enough anyhow. I usually, if I'm doing a commission, will work for maybe an hour or more writing O's in order to get warmed up and in perfect condition to put an O into a line of caps. Because you have to do this work all the time. Now, the H. Again, this simple little cusp, just a curved stroke. It is straight here and curved here, you'll see. So we'll do that so that we won't have to come back and finish what we started at the top of this H. You make the curve to the right, go into the wet ink as with a D, and then just make that simple stroke. It's this, you see. If the foot is that, at the head it's this. Up here at the head, you have it straight and then a curve. At the foot, it's a curve and then straight. Now, the crossbar on that H rests, as you learned before, on the midline, halfway between the writing line and the cap line. But notice a diagram here, something that you must pay a lot of attention to, because it gets some students into trouble. We have our writing line, waistline, cap line, and the center line. And our H then would be like this. There are various ways of putting these head serifs on, but finish the head while you're there. Now, in putting this down, some students get confused by that waistline. Ignore it. Pretend the waistline, if you're using guidelines, and you probably will be, ignore that waistline. Pretend it isn't there, because it is of no value at all when you're doing majuscules. Pay no attention to it. Now, if you're writing a minuscule letter, like an I, say, take a formal Roman I here. Same sort of serif might be used. So we'll have that waistline here, but that has nothing to do with this placing the horizontal on H and E on F, and of course nothing to do with the horizontal on A. Well, let's complete the H and then get on to the A. I like to do that first, and then come back and put the cusps in, complete the stem, swing over to the right, go into the wet ink, come down that way, and then add that simple foot serif. This should have been way over. With the A, a little concavity in that won't hurt. Come down with the corner of the pen and then just add this simple foot serif. And then on the right corner of the pen, draw the fillet, and then you push the ink into place. And this is why I'm working with this large pen, a larger pen than I've used before, just so that you can see how this is done. Now, the crossbar on A, remember, comes the width of the bar below the center line, so it's much lower than you'll find it on the H. Now, let me write another A. I don't like that one. Do the corner, draw the fillet, put the pen flat. Do the other corner, draw the other fillet. And then you can poke the ink into place. Lay that horizontal down. With a large size, you may have to lengthen that left side so that you can go into that with a flat pen angle, flat edge angle. And I like a little, very slight bend to the parts of A to give it a little more life. The N, steepen the pen so that you'll have a vertical thin stroke that is just about half the length of the thick stroke. In the Trajan inscription, the thin strokes are about half the weight of the thick ones. We draw that in. Now notice this. With the left corner of the pen, I draw the fillet, but this is so that I'll be able to get this diagonal, and the fillet will fill this in so that I have about the width of the whole pen. Now we go up on the left-hand corner. Now what do we do? It's going to be hard to keep that appointment down there, isn't it? Well, I would recommend that you put the right corner of the pen on that point and then go up straight above and put a dot down, because that will be the right side of the downstroke. See, there. Then come over and do the left fillet. I'm getting this a little wider than I wanted. And then come down and fix your eye on that point. Oh, I'm skidding. And complete it that way. Let me do it again without talking. The N is a very nice letter. It needs to be done with care, as all of these beautiful Roman caps do. A Roman from the first century in the Christian era, looking at our magazine and newspapers, would be delighted. He'd say, oh, those are our letters. He'd feel perfectly at home with the inscriptions we see in stone today. They're his letters. The W might bewilder him, the J, the U, but that's the way the M comes out. This, and to get a good one, I use that kind of cusped serif. The printer's term is cusped, C-U-S-P-E-D, and if you could write them with an edged pen, so that they look more like the brush-written letters of the Roman. But this is much quicker and much more practical, I think, for a penman than any other approach. The T. If we're doing rapid pen letters, we might as well look it. Again, knife over to the right, a little above the line, go over to the left, and lay that cusp in. See, it's so much more pleasurable than the drawing of letters with T-squares, straight edges, triangles, which I had to do when I was in school, and I hated it. And I thought there was some better way of doing letters, but couldn't be sure what it was. So I searched for it, and Edward Johnston showed me what the answer was. I knew there were times in the Middle Ages and Renaissance when they knew how to make letters. We won't be able to get through the alphabet in this lesson. the Romans were never in a hurry with their letters. Their alphabet, Rome wasn't built in a day, and believe me, their alphabet wasn't either. And if you take it, takes us a little longer, well, that's all right. You see, now that's the width of the downstroke. When you go up on corners, that takes us right down exactly to the writing line. Now, the beginner finds this difficult. To complete the head serifs and foot serifs on X while he's there, you may, if you have a job to do that requires an X, write the X and then go back and add the serifs. But get the professional trick of doing it by practice so that you won't have to do that always. You can make dry runs and decide about where that should come and then put the pen down. Trust to the whatever gods there are who created the alphabet. In all ancient cultures, it was believed that the gods created the writing. The Y, very much like the V, the X. And you're just below the middle part, then come down, knife over to the right, go over to the left, and add that nice cusp. Then as with the V, you add that. I would do it with a large pen, if possible, for quite a while if I were you, before trying it with the small pens. With the small pens, you won't see the mistakes, and that may be the cause of later trouble for you. Put the pen angle at absolute zero here for the diagonal so that it will have some strength. The italic Z with a thin diagonal seems weak compared to an austere Roman letter. We have K left in our series now. K, which is a little wider maybe than the four-fifths group, but it doesn't belong in the first family either. Now, you just have to learn by experience where to start that upper diagonal. I would make the pen perfectly at the edge at a 0-degree angle, and then twist it around to form the inner counter. And then on top of it, add this. Come in just above center. Touch the stem, don't go way into it. Now make a 90-degree angle with the upper arm and flatten the edge angle, and you have K solved. A tough, tough letter. In between words, the Romans used that brush-written sign. The letters were designed originally by professional scribes who did the writing for all sorts of official business, and they used reeds, later quills, and the stone-cut letters, which were written with a flat brush and then cut, were based upon designs originally made with the reed pen. Now let's try the third family, which begins with B. Swing over to the left, just above the writing line. Go over to the left. Now come up and then dip down a little bit, as with D. And I've spoken of shouldering before. That's just lifting up a little bit. Now, as you come around the upper part of B, steepen the pen, the angle, the edge angle. That makes a much more graceful terminal there. And then where that horizontal meets the curve, you start the bottom bowl and watch that point down there. Like that. E will always have, in our Roman printing types, that curve down there. And this is the origin of it. Then Or rotate on that upper corner a little faster than I did. Oh, that's a bad one. Had too much ink. You may or may not put the serif on that. Let me do a neater one. No, you'll be discouraged at first, as my students often are, but at Reed College, over and over again, they would complain so much about Roman caps when they were first introduced. And then in the next fall, when we had huge banners in the commons, I'd find that the banners would often be entirely in Roman caps. I'd say, well, how come? I thought you hated them. Well, they've been practicing during the summer and getting some skill in designing Roman caps. They didn't want to use any other alphabet. It does have authority and grace and beauty.